gun and a radio.
Not exactly Christmas, is it?
A gun and a radio. That's all you need. We're getting back to basics here. Welcome to an OALabs Patreon exclusive tutorial. Hopefully the first video you watch on our channel if you're just getting started with reverse engineering.
First time.
The purpose of this is just to explain how our environments are set up for reverse engineering and to give you some suggestions of how you might want to set up your environment. Now, if you're seeing this, it's because you're watching this video on YouTube. So just a quick shill for our Patreon. If you like this kind of content, go check it out. With that, let's jump in. It's the number one question we get asked. And in the past, I think we made some mistakes that I want to rectify here. We used to recommend installing FlareVM and a whole bunch of other tools, and I just don't think that's the right way to go. We get more questions about buggy FlareVM installs than we do about actually reverse engineering stuff. All you really need is IDA and a debugger. And that's really what this breaks down to. A gun and a radio, and maybe some air support if you're in real trouble. So let's talk about how we have our VM set up. If you've watched any of our streams, you'll see that there's no funny business here. This is literally the tooling that we use. If you guys can hear that snoring, it's my dog. Sorry, he's sleeping beside me. He's snoring up a storm. Okay, so anyway, if you watch our streams, you'll know that these are the tools that we use. We don't really use anything else, none of this fancy magic. And occasionally if we're dealing with some specific problem, we'll use some additional tools. But this is the baseline that you need. So first off, you need a Windows VM. Two Windows VMs, actually, but you can get away with one if you need it. Now, how do you get Windows? Well, hopefully, if you're reverse engineering, you know how to get Windows. But just in case you didn't know this, you can just download a Windows ISO from Microsoft and install it. You don't have to validate it or get a key for it or anything. You just download it and run it. They'll yammer at you to verify Windows, etc., but you can just use it. You can also just purchase a key off eBay or something like that if you want to. I'd recommend validating Windows, but again, you don't have to. And if you're really lazy, I don't recommend this, but if you're really lazy, you can just get one of those pre-built VMs from Microsoft. Those do actually expire though, so you gotta watch out for that. Now, the next question you're probably asking is, how do I run the VM? Well, it's your choice. And again, we get a lot of questions about hypervisor stuff. How do I set up my hypervisor? I mean, the truth is that I just use VMware, just straight up VMware. I pay them whatever the yearly thing is, $100 or something, and it just works, all right? I have a Mac host, I use VMware, and I use a Windows VM. Now, it's on you. If you wanna use VirtualBox, which is completely free, and you don't wanna shell out for the VMware, that's totally fine. VirtualBox also works. But after, I think, 7 years now of doing workshops, I've seen a lot of problems with VirtualBox, so I don't personally use it. I think it's buggy garbage, but if you don't have the money for VMware, you gotta use VirtualBox, go for it. If you wanna be a Chad and use Kemu, don't ask us for help. I use Kemu professionally, not in the tutorials. It takes a lot to get it set up. We're not doing a tutorial on it. Okay, so there's your hypervisor and your Windows guest in like 10 seconds. So the key part now comes with how to set up your VMs. Like I said, I use two VMs. One that's a clean VM for static analysis. The second that is a dirty VM for debugging. You can use only one VM if you're resource constrained, but I'm not gonna go through that setup because I don't recommend it. So I'm gonna go through the setup where you have two VMs. First, we'll talk about your static VM. Your static analysis VM is the VM where you're going to be doing most of your work. This VM should have network access. You should never run malware in this VM. It should be considered as clean as your host. And the reason why you have a clean VM is so that you can contain all of your notes, all of your work, your IDBs, everything inside of a nice snapshotted VM. And you can keep all your malware in there. Don't run it, but you can keep it in there. And as long as you use a snapshot, if anything should happen, at least it's not on your host. At least it's in a VM. I know a lot of people do static analysis on their bare metal host. That's totally fine if you want to do it that way. I don't. I like to keep it in a VM. So in my static VM, I have a few tools set up, and these are all I really use. I have IDA. I'm going to talk about that setup in just a minute. I have a hex editor. I have a Python interpreter. I have PE Bear for looking at PE files, which is a PE viewer. I have Visual Studio for compiling code. I have Resource Hacker for looking at resources. And I have DAI, and I have PE Studio, which I never use, but it's just there just in case I want to take a look at something. I'll talk about why I don't really use that in a minute. So for those different tools, the only thing where you really have any variation is what version of Visual Studio you install. If you're doing this on the cheap, just get the community version of 2022. It'll work fine for you. Also, for the hex editor, I use HXD, which is a super old ghetto 90s tool. The hex editor depends. Some people like to invest a lot in the hex editor. It's your choice, but HXD is what I use, and I use it just to view hex. That's it. I don't use it for struct building or anything like that. For IDA, I use IDA Pro, but you can get away with almost every tutorial we have on this site with IDA Free. If you get the latest version of IDA Free, you enable the network in your VM, you get a decompiler for 32-bit and a decompiler for 64-bit. These are the cloud decompilers for free, and you can disassemble stuff just fine. The only thing you can't do with IDA Free right now is, well, there's no local decompiler, so obviously you're sending binaries up to them, but that's fine for what we're looking at. And you don't get scripting. So anywhere where we're doing scripting or plugins, you don't have access to that. So that's what you're losing out on if you have IDA Free, but you can do all of the actual reverse engineering stuff with IDA Free. It's totally fine. If you want to use GeoHydra, that's great. I know a lot of people who use GeoHydra now as their daily driver. I hear it's good. GeoHydra. I don't personally use it, but I think all of the tutorials we have, you could actually complete with GeoHydra. Same goes for Binja. I like Binja. I use it for automation, but I don't use it as my daily driver just because I'm used to IDA and some of the quirks with IDA, which I've gotten familiar with over the years. So that's the baseline for our static analysis VM. Also, I have installed DNSpy EX, which I recently started using instead of just DNSpy, for .NET. You can't analyze .NET binaries in IDA. Well, you can, but it's garbage. So use DNSpy for static analysis. I also have a copy of DNSpy in my dynamic VM for dynamic analysis. We'll talk about that in a minute. So that's it for my static analysis VM. With those tools, you should be good to go. Again, as you encounter different techniques of malware, you may need additional tools, but that's the baseline. That should get you started. Once you have those installed, snapshot it, you're good to go. I also use a note-taking app, which is not in my VM. I actually use it on my host. I use JupyterLabs. Again, if you guys have seen any of the streams, you'll know this. It's just a markdown notebook that allows you to run Python in the notebook. So for every binary I analyze, I open a new JupyterLabs notebook, and I put my notes in there. Notes are annoying when you're in the thick of reverse engineering, but trust me, they help you a lot if you have to go back and revisit the binary later on. I do encourage you to take notes. Okay, static analysis done. Let's move on to dynamic analysis. And for dynamic analysis, you're gonna see it's even easier. So for dynamic analysis, the number one thing I do is shut off networking. No networking in the dynamic analysis VM. It can't connect to the network. No shared drives. I don't share any folders with the dynamic analysis VM. This is a dirty VM. It's bad. It has tons of malware running in it all the time. If you've watched any streams, you'll note I don't even revert the snapshots half the time. Half the time there's 10,000 pieces of malware running, I don't care. It's just a dirty box that I use. The tools that I have installed in this box are very simple. I use x6040bug, both the 32-bit and 64-bit versions of that. I try to stay updated to the latest release. There's a lot of features that come out with each release. So if you don't stay updated, you're gonna miss out. Now, sometimes I lag behind, as you guys might notice on the stream, but I try to stay as updated as possible. So in addition to having x6040bug, I actually have the same tools I have installed in my static analysis VM. So I have IDA, I have a hex editor, resource hacker, PE Bear, All those tools are installed in my dynamic analysis VM. Now, I don't use IDA with the network or anything like that. I don't actually do any reversing in IDA. It's just there so I can take a quick look at things inside of a familiar tool inside the debugging VM. So all of those tools are also in the debugging VM just in case I need them in addition to X64 debug. And like I mentioned, I also have a copy of DNSpy. Now I'm using DNSpy EX for debugging.net. So just the same tools, only now they're in the dirty VM with no network and no share folders. I also want to make a quick note about this, because if you watch this on stream, you'll know I do something very special for my debugging VM. I changed the background color of the debugging VM to something horrendous and ugly. Usually I'll use some sort of terrible purple or orange background. The reason why I do this is because I have the same setup and often the toolbar looks almost identical to my clean VM. I want an obvious visual reminder that I'm in the dirty VM. I'm in the debugger VM. Watch out. So what I do is I set the background color in the VM to something horrific. I know whenever I see that color, I'm in the danger VM. I should beware, right? And this is just so that I don't mess up the two VMs. I don't accidentally execute something in my static analysis VM. I don't accidentally turn on the networking for my dirty VM, etc. It's just a visual cue that I like to keep the two separate. Now, the last thing I install in my debugging VM is a way to monitor what the heck is going on. And I like to use System Informer, which is the new brand label for Process Hacker. It is, in my opinion, one of the most powerful tools that you can have in your debugging VM. So what it does is it gives you a process list of everything that's running. You can interact with processes, you can suspend them, kill them, investigate their memory, etc. I always have System Informer running in the side whenever I'm doing any sort of debugging. So that's your setup, a gun and a radio, right? You've got a static analysis VM, like five tools in it, dynamic analysis VM, same five tools, plus a debugger and System Informer. That's it. So now that you have these set up, let's talk about the error support. Why is this all we need in our VMs? Well, the reason why it's all we need in our VMs is because I rely quite heavily on a lot of automated tooling, some of which you have access to prior to actually hitting the VMs. So my workflow, if you've watched in our streams, my workflow in the stream usually starts after I already have an idea of what I'm looking at. And the way I get that idea is I actually run the sample through some dynamic analysis tools. Now, you guys don't have access to our internal tracing sandbox tool. You might at some point, but right now you don't. So you're gonna have to rely on open source sandboxes to get the same information. I would strongly encourage you before you start any sort of analysis to run your sample in a sandbox. There's plenty of free ones. You can use Cape. You can install Cape yourself if you like. You can use, AnyRun, Triage. What else are there? I can't remember. Those are the two big ones, plus Cape is the free one. If you don't have anything local set up, those are the ones you're going to use. I also use UNPACME.
UNPACME.
It's our own service. Obviously, we're shilling for it. But the truth is, nothing gets in the VM before it goes through UNPACME. The reason for this is because I don't want to do any sort of wasted work on unpacking samples. And not only does UNPACME unpack the samples, it'll oftentimes identify what the sample is. It'll give me information about the compiler. It gives me metadata information. So if it's .NET, it'll pull out extra .NET information. If it's Go, it'll pull out all the Go resym symbols. So it does a lot of that initial triage work for me before I get into the VMs. If I didn't have that service, if I couldn't rely on UNPACME, my VMs would look very different. I would have a lot of scripting and tracing tools for unpacking, but I don't need that because I'm using these powerful online services. So in a nutshell, that's your setup. And with this, I promise you, you should be able to complete any tutorial you see on our site, with the exception of plugins or scripting for IDA if you're using IDA free. All right, if you have any questions about that, hit us up on Discord, happy to answer them. Just don't ask me why is my VirtualBox not working. You already know the answer because you're not using VMware. All right, guys, see you on Discord.